First, I want you to stand up and wave and cheer support family and friends. Thank you. I'm sure you can find them out there. Show your love. It's a great honor for me to be here today. Now wait a second. I know that's such a cliche. You're thinking every graduation speaker here says that. It's a great honor. But in my case, it's really deeply so true. Being here is more special and more personal than most of you know. I'd like to tell you why. Long time ago, in this cold September of 1962, there's a Stephen Co-op at this very university. That co-op had a kitchen with ceiling that had been cleaned by student volunteers probably every decade or so. Picture a college girl named Gloria climbing up high on the ladder, struggling to clean that filthy ceiling. Standing on the floor, a young boy named Carl was admiring the view. And that's how they met. They were my parents. So I suppose you could say I'm the direct result of a kitchen and the chemistry experiment. My mama is here with us today, and we should probably go find a spot, put a plaque on the ceiling that says, "Thanks, Mama and Dad." Everyone in my family went here to Michigan. My brother, my mom, and my dad, all of us. My dad got actually a quantity discount. He got over 3.5 of his degrees here. His PhD was communication science because they thought computers were just passing fad, even when he earned it 44 years ago. He and mom made a big sacrifice for that degree. They argued at the times over pennies while raising my newborn brother. My mom typed my dad's dissertation by hand. The kind of ironic given it was a computer science dissertation. This velvet hood that I'm wearing, this is my dad's. This diploma? Yeah. This is the diploma that I have here, just like the one you're about to get. This is my dad's. And my underwear? Oh, never mind, sorry. My father's father worked in Chevy Flint, Michigan. He was an assembly line worker. He drove his two children here to Ann Arbor and told them, "This is where you're going to college." I know it sounds funny. Both of his kids actually did graduate from Michigan. That was the American dream. His daughter Beverly is also with us today. My grandpa used to carry an alley-oop hammer with heavy hunk of lead melted on the end. The workers made them during a sit-down strike to protect themselves. When I was growing up, we used the hammer whenever we needed to pound a stake or something into the yard. It is wonderful that people don't need to carry a heavy, blunt object for protection anymore. But just in case, I brought it with me. All right. My dad became a professor at Michigan State. And I was incredibly lucky boy. A professor's life is pretty flexible. He was able to spend woodloads of time raising me. Could there be a better upbringing than university brats? What I'm trying to tell you, this is why more than a homecoming for me. It's not easy for me to express how proud I am to be here with my mom, my brother, and Lucy, and with all of you at this amazing institution that is responsible for my very existence. I'm serious for all of you, and I'm serious for all of your family and friends. As all of us joined this great big Michigan family, I feel I've been a part of all of my life. What I'm most trying to tell you is I know exactly what it feels like to be sitting in your seat listening. Sam old Gasbag give a long-winded commencement speech. Don't worry, I'll be brief. I have a story about following dreams, or maybe more accurately, it's a story about finding a path to make those dreams real. You know how if you don't have what it feels like to wake up in the middle of the night with a vivid dream? You know how if you don't have a pencil and a pad by the bed, it will be completely gone by the next morning. I have one of those dreams when I was 23. When I suddenly woke up, I was thinking, what if we could download the whole web and just keep the link? I grabbed the pen and I started writing. Sometimes it's important to wake up and stop dreaming. I spent the middle of the night scribbling out the details and convincing myself it would work. It would work. Soon after, I told my advisor Terry Winograd, it would take a couple of time for me to download the web. He nodded knowingly, fully aware it would take much longer to download the web, but wise enough not to tell me. The optimism of youth is often underrated. Amazingly, at the time, I had no thought of building a search engine. The idea wasn't even on the radar. But much later, we happened upon a better way of working. We made a really great search engine, and Google was born. When a really great dream shows up, grab it. When I was here in Michigan, I've actually been taught how to make dreams real. I know that sounds funny. This is what I learned in summer program. Yeah, this is what I learned in summer camp converted into training program called Leadership. Yeah, we got a few out there. Their slogan is to have a healthy disregard for the impossible. They encouraged me to pursue a crazy idea at the time. I wanted to build a personal rapid transistor system on campus. Yeah, you're still working on that here. It was a futuristic way of solving our transportation problem. It was a futuristic way of solving our transportation problem. I still think a lot about transportation. You never lose a dream. It just incubates as a hobby. Many things people labor hard to do now, like cooking, cleaning, and driving, will require much less human time in the future. That is if you have a healthy disregard for the impossible. And actually builds the solutions. I think it's just often easier to make progress on make an ambitious dream. I know that sounds completely nuts. But since no one else is crazy enough to do it, you have little competition. In fact, there are so few people this crazy that I feel I know them all by first name. They will travel as if they were pack dogs, and they stick to each other like glue. The best people want to work on the big challenges. That is what happened with Google. Our mission is to organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful. How can that not get you excited? We almost didn't start Google actually because my co-founder Sergey and I were too worried about dropping out of PhD program. You are probably on the right track if you feel like a sidewalk worm during a rainstorm. That's about how we felt after we maxed out 3 credit cards buying hard disk off the back of the trunk. That was actually first hardware for Google. Parents and friends, more credit cards always help. What is one sentence summary of how you change the world? Always work hard on something uncomfortably and exciting. As a PhD student, I had 3 projects I wanted to work. Thank goodness my advisor said, why don't you work on the web for a while? He gave me some seriously good advice, because the web is growing with people and activity. Even in 1995, technology and especially internet can really help you be lazy. Lazy? What I mean is a group of 3 people can write software that 10 million can use and enjoy. Can three people answer the 4 million tabs? Find leverage in the world so you can be truly lazy. Yeah. Overall, I know it seems like the world is crumbling out there. It's a really great time in your life to get a little crazy, follow your curiosity, and be ambitious about it. Don't give up on your dream. The world needs you all. So here's my final story. On a day like today, you might feel exhilarated, like you've been just shut out of a can at the circus. And even invisible. Don't ever forget that incredible feeling. But also, always remember the moment we have with friends and family, the chances we have to do things that might make a big difference in the world, or even to make a small difference to the ones we love. All those wonderful chances that life gives us, life also takes away. It can happen fast and a lot sooner than you think. In late March 1996, soon after I started to move back to Stanford for grad school, my dad had difficulty breathing and drove to the hospital. 2 months later, he died. I was completely devastated. Many years later, after startup, after falling in love, and after many of life's adventures, I found myself thinking about my dad. Lucy and I were following Steamingham Village, walking through narrow street. There were wonderfully friendly people everywhere. But it was a desperately poor place. People used the bathroom inside, and it flowed out into the open gutter and straight into the river. We touched the boy with a limp leg, the result of paralysis from polio. Lucy and I were rural India, one of the few places polio still exists. Polio is transmitted fecal to oral, usually through filthy water. Well, my dad had polio. He went on a trip to Tennessee in his first grade, and he caught it. He had a difficulty breathing his whole life. He went on a trip to Tennessee in his first grade, and he caught it. He was hospitalized for two months, and had to be transported by military D-3 back home. His first flight. He wrote, then I had to stay in bed for over a year before I started back to school. This is actually a quote from his fifth grade autobiography. My dad had difficulty his whole life. The complications of polio were what took him from us too soon. He would have been very upset that polio still persists, even though we have a vaccine. He would have been equally upset at the back in India, we have a polio on our shoes, walking through contaminated gutter that spread the disease. We are spreading the virus with our every footsteps right under the beautiful kids playing everywhere. The world's on the verge of eliminating polio, with 328 people infected so far this year. Let's get it eradicated soon. Perhaps one of you will do that. My dad was valedictorian of Flint Mandeville High School class of 1956 of about 90 kids. I happened across graduating speech recently, and it blew me away. 53 years ago, my dad said, "We are entering a changing world, one of automation and employment change, where education is an economic necessity. We'll have increased periods of time to do as we wish. As our work week or our retirement age that we wish our truth, we shall take part in our witness and development to this day, to development in science, medicine, and industry. We can only dream of today. It's said the future of any nation can be determined by care and preparation given its youth. If all the youth of America were as fortunate in securing an education as we have been, if our views of America, the future of the United States, can be more bright than it is today. If my dad were alive today, the thing I think he would be most happy about is that Lucy and I have a baby in the hopper. Yeah, it's called Lucy. I think he would be annoyed that I hadn't got my PhD yet, thanks Michigan. My dad was so full of insight of excitement about new things. To this day, I wonder what he would think about new development. If you are here today, it being one of the best days of his life. He'd be a kid in a candy store. For a day, he'd be a kid again. He'd be young again. Many of us are fortunate enough to be with family and friends. Some of us have dear friends and family to go home to. And who knows, perhaps some of you, like Lucy and I, are dreaming of future families of your own. Just like me, your family has brought you here, and you brought down here. Please keep them close, and remember, they are what really matters in life. Thanks, Mom, thanks, Lucy, and thank you all very much.